Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. And I want to make a video about how to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I need to do one that lays out the teaching of Bible verses and stuff, right? And I've done some, but I need to do a great one, but, you know, really going into it. And then I need to discuss about how do you know when you're really saved. And I started to, you know, go through those Bible verses. I'm going to do that, but I want to make a video first, brothers and sisters, and talk about, and really preach it. You know, there's teaching and preaching. Lots of times people want me to teach. And, you know, because it's great if you, most of the teaching on YouTube is by people, you know, that have are not preachers, and then they didn't go to Bible school. Now, you don't have to go to Bible school to be, you know, to hear from God. But going to Bible school, like I did for 4 years, is a foundation to know how to study. Just like any discipline you look at, whether it be, or any discipline, like a historian. You know, there are people who are doctors of history, and they specialize in, you know, early American colonial history, or Middle East history, or whatever it is. But if you go get a bachelor's degree in history, what you learn is how to study history. You really get the foundation of study, and where to go, what's the best sources, and all that to go study. So same thing is true with theology. If you do go to Bible school, it gives you the foundation to start knowing where to look and how to look. And what's the, not only in theology, but if you take any kind of a college degree, you usually learn the academic standards. In other words, how to decide whether a book from the Bible is legitimate or not. You know, how do they know that it's really supposed to be in the Bible and all that kind of stuff. So those same techniques of academic standards as applied to the Bible as it would be to evolution. That's why if you ever want to debate or get into it with people that believe in evolution, you have to use academic standards on those academic, you know, the people that are thinking right here with their minds to believe in evolution. You have to meet them where they are. That's why you have to start talking to them using the same, you know, scholarly standards that they use, and meet them there and say, hey, wait a minute. Science is, by definition, the definition of science is the observation of nature. So you, no one has observed evolution. So therefore, right off the bat, it doesn't fall in the category of a science. It's a pseudoscience and a theory, and not a fact, right off the bat. You know me, brothers and sisters. I came on here because the Lord led me to come on here and preach. And I want to talk to you about, and I'll probably title this video, you know, the secret of receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and the secret of walking with the Lord, the secret of knowing that you're saved. You know, and there's all these Bible verses that I want to teach about, but I want to preach about it, brothers and sisters, because the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach His Word. So it's like this. You want to know if you're saved? Let's do that one first. Let's talk preaching style. You want to know you're saved? Romans 8:14 says, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans 8:16 says, Romans 8 verse 16 says that His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. So if you look at the Bible, you'll see in Genesis, when Jacob, you know, people talk about the nation of Israel and all that. Actually, there was a man called Israel, but his real name was Jacob. He was born as Jacob, the supplanter, the heel grabber. When his older brother Esau came out, Jacob came out grabbing the heel of his older brother. That's why they called him Jacob. He said, here, his original name is a supplanter. You know, the bottom of your foot, they call it a plantar, like a plantar's wart, not a planter's wart. You know, when I was a kid, you know, I came from a, you know, rural area, and especially my mom's side of the family came from up in the Bedford, Virginia area, in the mountainous area there near Bedford, Virginia. Very rural people, and then they would say a planter's wart. I guess lots of people say, but it's plantar, referring to the bottom of your foot, T-A-R, not T-E-R. So anyway, you know, I mean, that's, you know, we do that all the time. We all do that all the time with a misunderstanding what the word, and it becomes something else. And so that's an example. Anyway, so he was a supplanter. He was grabbing the heel of his brother's foot and tried to take his place. And so he did. In the story, you'll see, if you read Genesis. I recommend everyone read Genesis as a history book first. Before you, that's so funny. There's people that they saw something on YouTube and then they're, you know, they're getting all this typology, they call it, and shadows and trying to, you know, figure out who's the Antichrist and the end of times and all that from Genesis. But they haven't even read it through first themselves as a history book. It needs to be read first as a history of God's dealing with man from the creation all the way through to the death of Joseph. That's why Genesis begins with such promise. In the beginning was God. And the last book of the last verse of Genesis ends with, in a coffin in Egypt. So the Bible begins with God and the promise of his creation and perfection and paradise. And Genesis ends with Joseph being dead and buried in a coffin. So it starts with God and life and ends with death. But Genesis is only the beginning of the story, right? And there's plenty of types and shadows in Genesis that we can follow. But like I said, the problem is people don't have a foundation in the Word of God. They're just running to and fro on YouTube, watching all these videos. That's why, you know, some people have 30,000 subscribers. I don't. By the grace of God, one day I will have 30,000 subscribers. It's up to the Lord. My purpose is to get on here and give the truth and not tickle anybody's ears. By the grace of God, the best I can, to be humble myself and be led by the Spirit and give the truth of God. Barring, no matter what people think, not to be barred or rebuked by man, but to walk in the Spirit of God and humility. For God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. So, brothers and sisters, the secret to being saved and knowing you're saved, that's probably the number one question people ask me. How do I know I'm saved? His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. So Jacob, who is a supplanter, he stole his brother's, he bought his brother's birthright for a bowl of soup, and then later on his mom disguised him as his brother because his dad was almost blind, Isaac, sent him in there under the direction of his mama because God had prophesied to his mama that the younger would rule over the older, or the older would serve the younger. Esau would serve Jacob. But God had said that to the mom. And the dad loved Esau so much, his other son, he was going to give him, and he was his oldest son, he was going to give him the blessing of the oldest son. But the mom conspired with Jacob and told Jacob, go in there and pretend like you're your brother, and then your dad will give you the firstborn birthright. So he was supplanted his brother's birthright. He stole it, really, even though that's what God had already said was going to happen. As God said, Jacob have I loved and Esau have I hated. So God foreknew and predestined Jacob, and through the seed of Jacob, the nation of Israel would come forward. And then, of course, the Messiah, Jesus Christ. So anyway, after Jacob had gone into exile, his parents sent him away because his brother Esau said, as soon as our dad dies, Isaac dies, I'm going to kill Jacob. You know, so they sent him away, and he got a wife, two wives, and their two helpers who also were his wives too, or concubines. And so here he came back after all these years, like 20 years living in exile, working for his uncle Laban. He came back to Israel and to the what is now the land of Israel. Then it was the land of Canaan. And when he came back, the day before he met his brother Esau, he knew that he was going to be meeting his brother Esau after 20 years. And he thought, hey, my brother's going to kill me. And he was in that point of, you know, I can do a whole video just on this one point. Maybe I will. Salvation, the secret to know you're saved. Okay. Now I'll make another secret to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, to be healed. So anyway, Jacob was really afraid, and he was praying about it and all this, and called on the name of the Lord and prayed. And then during the night, he wrestled with the angel of the Lord, which they call a theophany or a Christophany. I mentioned this before, a pre-incarnated Christ, and someone asked me, you know, what is that? Because I would just suggest that people need to Google and make it a lot easier for everybody. There's the blessing of the internet, you can Google anything. So a theophany is a vision of God or someone seeing God. And Christophany specifically is seeing the Lord Jesus Christ before he came to earth as the Son of Man, born to the Virgin in about 1 or 2 BC. So before that, there's examples of what we call a Christophany, where the Lord, the captain of the Lord's host, in the Old Testament, but the real name in Hebrew, which is used in the New Testament, the Lord of Sabaoth, is used twice in the New Testament. Hebrews, Romans chapter 4, I believe it is. It's used in another Bible verse in the New Testament. Anyway, so Hebrews, it's in Hebrews chapter 12. Jesus is the Lord of Sabaoth and the captain of the armies of the host of the Lord. So Joshua saw the pre-incarnated Christ, the Christophany, at the Battle of Jericho, just before they attacked. When he saw a man, he said, "Are you for us or against us?" And he said, "I'm not for you or against you. I'm the captain of the Lord's host. Take off your shoes. You're standing on holy ground." It's the only time, you know, Moses did that in the burning bush, when God is present. You know, and then Paul tells us that Jesus was in the burning bush. So when the Lord Jesus Christ is present, or, you know, God, to be worshipped, that's when it's holy ground. So, and then with Jacob, he wrestled with the angel of the Lord. And then he told the angel of the Lord, they wrestled all night. And the angel of the Lord said, "Let me go." And he said, "I will not let you go till you bless me. I will not let you go till you bless me." And it says that the angel of the Lord touched the inside of his thigh, and ever since that day, Jacob walked with a limp. But he said to him, you know, that's kind of a type of Paul in the thorn in the flesh, you know, in his weakness. You know, God's grace is manifested through his weakness. He told Jacob, "I'll change your name. You're no longer called Jacob, but Israel, because you are somebody who wrestled with God and man and overcame." Now, just to follow up on that teaching, the angel of the Lord, Christophany, the Lord Jesus Christ, appearing in the Old Testament before he came as the Son of Man, he called Jacob Israel and said, "Because you've wrestled with God and man and overcame." See, he was wrestling with God. The angel of the Lord said, "You have wrestled with God and man and overcome." So he was wrestling with who? Esau. He wrestled with Laban, his mama's brother, his uncle. He wrestled with him for 20 years. He wrestled with his brother Esau. And then he wrestled, you know, Jacob had lots of times he was wrestling with everybody everywhere he went. He had kind of a hard time because he was a supplanter. But the Lord changed his name to "He who wrestles with God and man overcomes." Now that also matches the nation of Israel. The nation of Israel itself has wrestled with God and man since its beginning. They wrestled with God because they rejected Jesus as the Messiah. They wrestled with God before that, before Jesus came, because they didn't want to obey the Ten Commandments. They wrestled with God with a golden calf. They wrestled with God all through their history. Even today, Israel keeps wrestling with God. They wrestled with man because, look, everyone tries to kill the Jews. Everybody hates the Jews. Everybody wants to kill the Jews, except for your serious evangelical born-again Christians on this earth. Everybody else wants to kill the Jews. Hitler, they've wrestled with man. They've wrestled right now. They wrestle with the Palestinians and all that stuff and all the Muslim countries. Israel as a nation is fulfilling the title that they have. Some people try to say it means Prince of God. Whenever you want to know the definition of something, it'll be written right in there. When Jacob's wives, every time they had a child, they gave the child's name and the meaning of it. You know, and like when Judah was born, she said, "I will praise God for another son. Therefore, he was called Judah," which means, you know, praise God. So, in Hebrew. So, all of their names mean something. So, the angel of the Lord Jesus Christ, he told Jacob, you will be called Israel because you wrestled with God and man and overcame. That's the meaning. Just like Abraham means father of many nations. God told him, "You'll no longer be called Abram, but Abraham, because you will become the father of many nations." So that's how we know the definition. And the definition of Hebrew is set from the Word of God. The Word of God is giving us the definition of the Hebrew words from the Old Testament. Even in the New Testament, when you see words translated, it'll tell you what it means. So we don't need to look at any other source. The translation is right there in the text. So if you want to know if you're saved, it says His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Romans 8:16. So you got to get in there. That's what you got to do. What I'm telling you this story for those of you who are so carnal minded, get in your spirit mind. Get in, let your spirit, stop letting your flesh, like Jacob, the hill supplanter, let his flesh rule and reign his life. And that's how he had all that trouble. But when he wrestled with the Spirit of the Lord, then after that, he became he who wrestles with God and man and overcomes. So he began to walk in the Spirit. And in his flesh, he had a limp. In the weakness of his flesh, he was made perfect in Christ. God, just like what Paul would, and his thorn in the flesh, same thing as the thorn in the flesh with Paul, that in his weakness, God's strength is manifested. And that's exactly what happened to Jacob. So you who are strong in the flesh, that's the problem with all these. I talk about it all the time. These greasy gracers, when I say greasy gracers, I mean denominational people, particularly Baptist and liberal from that, your old mainline Protestant denominations. They don't even believe you have to say our sinner's prayer. But let's just play along here and say, you know, Presbyterians, Lutherans, Methodists, all of those old mainline denominations, the original Protestant denominations, and through Catholicism, all the way to the end, Catholicism all the way up to Baptist. Greasy gracers, I'm talking about people that think you can say a prayer one time when you're 18 years old, 10 years old, get water baptized, live like the devil all your life, even deny, you know, become an atheist or believing in evolution, whatever you want to do, and you're still going to heaven. That's the term I'm using, greasy grace, because they think it's, hey, it's just like, say that sinner's prayer when you're 8 years old, live like the devil all you want. But Romans 8:14 says, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the children of God. And then it says in verse 16, His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're children of God. That's what I'm trying to tell you. That's what I tell people who message me, which is probably the number one question I get asked. How do I know that if I'm saved? You got to get in there, get in the ring, just like what Jacob did. He got in there with the angel of the Lord and wrestled with him. He wrestled with the angel of the Lord and did not let go until the angel of the Lord changed his name. Now, when you look at Jesus, when he met the apostles, what did he do? He changed their name. He saw Simon. He said, you will no longer be called Simon, but I'll call you Peter. Cephas, you're a stone. You know, he changed his name. He changed those the apostles' names. He gave them like their born-again name. They have a new meaning and a new destiny in Christ. You know, the Bible says that you and me, we were once lost without hope and sin in this world, but we've been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. We've got a new beginning, a new name. Our blood is changed from type A, B, C, D, or type S for sin, to a blood type of J for Jesus Christ. We've got a new blood type, a new family history. It doesn't matter what background you came from, just like Jacob with all the stuff he went through. But he had a new beginning and a new birth in his relationship with God when he wrestled with the angel of the Lord. And he came out of it with the blessing of God upon him. Now the same thing is true for you. You have to get in there and wrestle with the Lord. Stop letting your flesh lead you. That's what I'm talking about with the greasy gracers and all that. They're strong in their flesh. They're strong in their flesh, and they let their lives be ruled and reigned over by sin. And that's why people love the doctrine of once saved, always saved, so they can wallow around in their sin like a pig going back to the miry clay, or a dog licking up his own vomit. They want to go back into that pigsty like the prodigal son in the video I made the other day. They want to keep wallowing around with those pigs in the mud and live like hell and say, well, you know, I know that one day my daddy's going to come get me. But just like in the story of the prodigal son, the dad didn't come get him. It says the prodigal son came to himself and said, hey, wait a minute. I am living worse and lower than a pig. I'm eating the leftover pig slop here. And in my dad's house, even the servants is living like a king compared to me. So what did it do? It said he repented. He came to himself. He got up and went back home. And said, Father, forgive me. I've sinned against God and in your presence. I'm not worthy to even be treated as one of your servants. That's repentance. That's repentance. We have to come to ourselves and go back to the Lord. That's why I'm telling you, you've got to get in there and wrestle and wrestle and wrestle with the Lord until you know, till His Spirit tells you. You know, for those of you who don't understand King James, His Spirit bears witness with our spirit. In other words, no one can tell you you're saved. That's the thing about it. All these people that's worried if they're saved, then they keep looking online or they go to churches so they find some old greasy grace, spiritually dead, false teacher telling them, oh yeah, you're saved. No person. Have you ever heard when Jesus said, judge not, lest you be judged? People love to use that when they say, oh, this guy's evil, he's going to hell. Oh, don't judge. What about if I say, hey, this guy's great, he's going to heaven? That's also judging. You have no right to tell anybody they're going to heaven. You can't tell people, oh, you're going to heaven individually. Now you can say, oh yeah, if you pray, you repent, blah, 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 you can go to heaven, you'll go to heaven. Yeah, it's a general statement. You can't tell, hey, I know that you know, that Brother Patrick, I know that he's saved and I know he's going to heaven. You don't know that. You assume that based on the fruit that you see from my videos and from Joshua's ministry. You assume that. But only God is the judge. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Don't let any man tell you that you're saved or not saved. You got to get in there and wrestle with the Lord until you know in your spirit man. The Bible calls it your heart, not your soul, not your consciousness. The flesh consciousness. The man is made up of three parts, the Bible tells us. Your flesh, your physical body, your soul, which is your mind, your consciousness, your, you know, it says, hey, look at that pretty naked woman. You know, when you look at pornography, that part of you. And then your spirit man. The Bible says that the spirit of a man is a candle of the Lord. Okay? And God searches us out through our spirit. God speaks to our spirit. When people hear from God, people get a word from the Lord, it doesn't go to their mind, it goes to their spirit man. When I hear from God, it goes to my spirit man. And then my spirit man is the one talking to my brain and saying, hey, God is speaking through my spirit man. It's like a receiver, the radio in me. Transmission from God comes through my spirit. The devil can't speak to my spirit. There's people say the devil talked to him. He's not talking to their spirit. He speaks to your mind, your soul. He can whisper in your ear. He speaks to your eye gates, they say. You know, you got your eye gates, ear gates. You know, I see some naked women. I see, you know, that some beer. I say, oh, I'd like to drink that beer. It's the flesh. Through the flesh. You know, the devil, you know, it's in my mind. Oh, I hate my neighbor. I want to kill him because he's a jerk. He keeps throwing his garbage in my yard. Whatever. That's the flesh. Totally different than the spirit man. That's why the Bible says in Hebrews 4:12 that the word of God is sharper than a two-edged sword. It can divide apart even the bone and marrow, even the, you know, it divides the spirit and the soul and the flesh. That's why you need to read the Bible. 90% of the people or more, I don't know, they don't know the word of God. That's the problem. People don't know the word of God. So the answer to the question is, how do you know that you're saved? The secret to knowing that you're saved, you got to get in the ring. And you got to be willing to keep wrestling with the Spirit of the Lord and wrestling with the Lord and wrestling with the Lord until, you know, you got to keep on wrestling with him until he's going to bless you and tell you, yes, you're saved. You got to seek him. Knock and ask is what I'm talking about. I'm talking about pressing in. Just like the one with the issue of blood, I could go on and on. She pressed in. She pressed in and pushed through the thong and touched him. Lots of people touched Jesus. But he didn't say, oh, there's 100 people. He said, no, who touched me? Because virtue went out of me. Somebody touched me by faith. Who touched me? And then Peter said, hey, there's lots of people touching you. What are you talking about? And he said, no, somebody touched me by faith. That's different. Just like the blind man outside Jericho. Jesus was passing by, and he kept yelling, Jesus, thou son of David. That's a title for the Messiah that they used in Israel. Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy. And the people told him, oh, shut up. Be quiet. Be quiet. Don't trouble the master. But he kept on yelling even more loud, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy. It says, Jesus stopped, asked him, what can you do for me? He said, that I might receive my sight. Jesus prayed for him and he was healed and he could see. Because he was persistently, fervently seeking after God. You want to know if you're saved? You got to stop running around on YouTube and asking people and trying to get people to endorse your sin. And, you know, and tell you, the Bible says there's one mediator between God and man, that's a man, Jesus Christ. And the word religion is a pejorative to me, which means a bad word. And the word religion is all about man trying to make himself a mediator between you and God. Now, that's why people have a hard time understanding my videos, and they want to run to and fro to somebody that's going to give them a little baby milk and tickle their ears and tell them what they want to hear. The mission of this channel is to give you the tools and give you the meat so that you can find out from God yourself and stop looking to man to save you and help you and tell you what to do, that you would have your own personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, because the Lord has no grandchildren, no cousins and all this stuff. You can't have a secondhand faith. You must have personal faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. You must personally get a hold of the Lord. Jesus said, no man can come to me unless their father, my Father draws them. He said, my sheep know my voice, and they answer not to another. You need to know the Lord's voice. Do you know the Lord's voice? And when I hear these people on YouTube and on television mocking about, oh, people think God speaks to them. What's wrong? Jesus said, my sheep know my voice, and they answer not to another. Jesus said, the Holy Spirit will speak not of himself, but he'll be talking about me. The Holy Spirit speaks in the heart of Christians. People say God don't speak and all this stuff, there's no gifts of the Spirit and all that. You can't be saved without talking to God. You have to have a personal relationship and contact with the Lord through His Holy Spirit. Talking through the Holy Spirit to God, to the Lord Jesus Christ. That is what it means to be saved. To speak and hear from the Lord by His Spirit. By His Spirit. By His Spirit. God is real. He's the great I Am. He is here with us. All you got to do is get a hold of Him yourself. Fervently seek the Lord and you shall find. Jesus said, seek and you shall find. It's a promise from the Lord Himself. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it'll be open to you. Ask and you shall receive. Go after the Lord with all of your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your body. The Bible says if you seek and search for God with all your heart, you'll find Him. Seek Him right now. Jeremiah 33:3, call upon me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you know not. Draw close to me and I'll draw close to you. Another Bible verse from Jeremiah. Get a hold of the Lord today and stop worrying about what's going on the news. The rapture might not be for another 50 years. We don't know that. It could be tomorrow. What difference does it make if you're not saved? What difference does it make if you're not doing God's will? How can you do God's will if you're not sin? It tells us in Romans chapter 10. How can people hear if nobody tells them, and how can somebody tell them if they're not sent? God wants you to go or help somebody else go. And how do you know what to do if you don't hear from God? Get off of all of this foolishness on YouTube and all of this wild speculation and on and on and on. I mean, how many times do you have to be tricked and fooled by all this foolishness before you say, hey, I got to stop listening to these people that's not called by God. And they get some theory and run wild with it and just make a career off of this one little thing that they see, you know, some little idea and run wild with it on YouTube and news reports. And the news of the world is always bad. There's nothing new about that. The world is going from bad to worse. We know that. But the good news is that we are safe in Christ. Get on the good news and get off the bad news. Get a hold of the Lord Jesus Christ today. Spend your time and energy seeking God today. Seek Him while He may be found, the Bible says. You know not what tomorrow holds. Jesus says don't worry about what you're going to wear, what you're going to eat and all this stuff. And through worrying you can add 1 inch to your height or add no more hair to the top of your head. But today seek ye the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all those earthly things you want will be added unto you. The evil of today is sufficient to keep you busy, Jesus said. Don't be worried about what's going to happen tomorrow or what happened yesterday. You know, I've got one relative, and all they do is obsessed about what happened 40 years ago, 50 years ago. That's all they spend their whole life. They're trapped in 1965. You know, that's gone. Today's the day to repent of what happened then and move on. And today is not the day to worry about what's going to happen next week. God called us and Jesus commanded us to walk in the Spirit today. Why it's called today. You ask the Lord to give you daily bread. The manna that's a day old it goes bad. And the manna from tomorrow hasn't failed yet. You got to eat your daily bread. God wants us to go day by day by day, one day at a time, like that song, Sweet Jesus, one day at a time, depending on Him to deliver you, Him to sustain you. He is the good shepherd that feeds His sheep daily. Daily trust in the Lord. Stop being so high-minded and humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, like what happened to Jacob. He stopped being so high-minded and he was humbled by his experience with wrestling with God. God bless you guys. Got another video to make by the grace of God about the secret to receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit.